God-given thing. It was what our government did to people. And so they found their way back here, which is David's original home, and came back here for refuge. And I met him shortly thereafter, and there was a connection because I was still trying to find family members of mine that were affected by the dream as well. And so we adopted or something, and I'm very pleased that it was your business. Yeah. It was like, oh God, it's my brother. And so I've seen changes in David's work since he got here. Some of you have known him since he's been here in Chicago, of the new family?
Yes.
So you've seen some of the changes in his work, and we're going to be talking about that a little bit. But David, this particular show, Skin Deep, this came after a little bit of break from doing your fine art. Tell us about that break and what that
meant. A few years ago, I guess about 2.5, I got really frustrated with trying to be successful as an artist. And by successful, I mean, you know, pay the light bill, take a vacation once a year, you know, make sure stuff is good, just be able to support my family doing what I'm doing. And I got really frustrated with that because I felt like I was hitting my head in this room. And I also, throughout my career as an artist, but as my work got more abstract, I used it less and less. And so I found myself drawn to that as a means of still being creatively expressive, but potentially being better able to support my family, feeling like I was an artist still. I could still be an artist, be creative, but pay for my bills. That didn't really work either. And so I think more than anything, I got to a place where I felt like it wasn't enough of an outlet. Like I needed to physically manipulate the materials. And I wasn't doing that with the camera. I was shooting a lot of digital photography. Even the film stuff, I still wasn't moving materials around on the surface. And so it called back to me. And this new work is now very much informed by the photography that I spent some of that time doing. And it's about, and I'm trying to find a balance between all of it.
And in finding that balance, how did working with photography for the 2.5 years inform this new work that's on the show?
90% of the images, I was all but two of the images on my photography. No, I'm sorry, four. The two portraits from when I was a teenager. That my dad's also a photographer. And so those two portraits. But they're actually portraits that I've taken throughout the time of me doing photography. And then, like, while I was working on the photography, I found myself going back into the beauty, nuance, and intricacy of the human face, of the people, the expressiveness of the experience that happens with the shoot, how much of who they are can kind of ooze out at the end of the hour and a half that I spend doing the photo shoot, and how much of that I can capture. And so a lot of that kind of bled back into the camera.
Which two pieces were from your father's photography?
The left of the small pieces, the top two on the left side.
The military jacket?
Yes, the two military jackets. One is of me at 16, and the other is a classmate who was there at the same time.
Oh, because I thought those were very modern shots, like you put on the two. The Bronzeville Military Academy, especially the girl, she looks really right this minute. But you weren't on the set.
I was just going to say, how old am I?
Right this minute, I guess you'll feel it. Okay.
No.
Okay.
a mentor in college was John Scott, New Orleans artist. He's shown and exhibited work kind of all over the country. And some few places internationally. Figurative abstract artist with a really radical habit. And a lot of me making the decision to become an artist, feeling or coming to the conclusion that I can do this. Like, it's not just something I like doing, but it is a big chunk of who I am as a human being. Evolved.
I'm always stuck when you talk about your previous work and you talk about how heavily abstract it is.
Mm-hmm.
And that is not what I would ever call it.
Okay.
Ever. In a million years.
Okay.
I
struggle with what to call it all the time.
And that is always a concern about when we as artists have to be outside of ourselves and talking about what it is.
Right.
That we have to work under labels that other people pretty much decided what that is.
Yeah.
But you are a child of the Black Arts Movement, and that you were not participating during the Black Arts Movement time, where there was a kind of synergy going across the country. The same time Chicago's Afro-Cobra, in St. Louis, it was BAC, in Oakland, it was the Open Bay Area artists, who are all kind of working at the same time, the same kind of way, and with a certain kind of mission. John Biggers also had that mission, and the mission was to narratively tell our story in a very proud and profound way, and something that was very literal, so the least of us could grab hold as well as the most learned. And so I'm a little older than David, so I'm not part of the Black Arts Movement, but not that far behind. David really was in school at a time where you could then study the Black Arts Movement. You couldn't study the Black Arts Movement. In fact, in Jansen's history of art, there were no Black artists when I was in undergraduate.
There were like the region.
There weren't any when I was in undergraduate. None.
Right. No, I know. I'm trying to remember the book. I seen like four artists in the class.
There are only three now.
Yeah. I'm trying to remember some black artists. And all of the, all the artists that influenced me more than anything were the ones that were around me. They were, I considered him my mentor and my contemporary because he was a living to working artist. He wasn't just teaching us, he was constantly out doing that. And we were having a conversation about the artists, the two names that I came when I was just thinking about who influenced me. And it was just really interesting to find out that that I didn't even know that the other was also an educator. And I also work as an educator for the artist. And so to have that underneath and not even be aware of it.
So tell me something, because you are not an MFA, correct?
No.
Do you consider going back to school?
Yes.
To get an MFA? Can you tell us why?
So that I'm better. So that I'm able to get a better paying job and teach at a university. And I think the drive. job, and is to be able to do whatever it is that I want to do. And, you know, living as an artist, you want to sell your work, because it's my source of income as well as it is my passion. And like I was saying, sometimes you feel like you're being hit against the wall, you struggle. And you want to be able to support yourself as that. And then there's also, I love teaching. My wife always says that I'm an amazing teacher. And I'm just like, I just like sharing what I know. You know, I kind of teach the same thing to second graders that I teach to college students. You know, and I've dumbed it down for second graders. Like, you know, I've had second graders learn quadrilateral symmetry in an afternoon. And they can't say it when they go home, but they might do it. And
I guess it is.
Right, I mean, it's so like, I love education, but I also love the fact that it can afford me the opportunity to be able to paint what I want to paint, or photograph what I want to photograph, draw, sculpt, whatever it is I'm driven to do at that moment, because I do a lot of it. And also just sharing in that kind of being able to pass, or that stream of being able to pass on what I have. Because I'm very much an experimenter and an explorer in the creative process. And I like to push that out to other people. Like, you know, I come across new ways to do stuff. Some of them are driven by the economy or lack of. You know, we talk about that, you know, all the time, and I figure out how to do stuff, because I can't go, you know, I can't buy it, so I'm going to make it.
Well, that's been still being very close to a student.
Right.
Because as a student, you always, you know, unless your name is tied to the Rockefellers, quite often you find out another way to make something other than that list that you're given.
Right.
Class above the product that you need to go out and buy.
And I think Alfred needs to.
It is an encaustic piece in the car right now. I picked it up and I started smelling it. I was like, oh, how heavenly. His children hate the smell of beeswax, but I love it. And I asked, was it indeed beeswax? Because when I was undergraduate school and I couldn't afford beeswax for the product that I was working on, I bought the commode ring. Oh, it melts the same way, it's the same color, it burns the same way, it's a tenth of price.
And it is actually beeswax. Because I had to do that, because I had to say my thing. I was like, it said a wax ring, and I said, well, I'm so whipping on it, and I'm like, well, what kind of wax is this? Because it looks like beeswax. And I've changed a couple of toilets, because I can't afford a plumber. So, I know how to take a toilet, so I've seen it. You know, usually I, you know, so I know what pressure looks like. Painting or drawing realistic faces that, you know, that were recognizable. to simplify and come back to what was natural. A lot of my color palette, my older color palette, was described to me in college as Crayola by an instructor. And I didn't know really if that was a jab, an observation, or a compliment. And I never clarified that, because she was like, you're color palette. And so I just run with it as a compliment, like I'm like a kid. I just go with the compliment. But I don't think that she meant it as a compliment.
Okay, may I ask the race of this person?
She was black.
Okay, so it is possible that it's a jab. Yeah. It's also possible because with Afro-Fro, the palette is either called Kool-Aid color or Crayola color.
Okay.
So they use both words interchangeably. And it was used very specifically. Mm-hmm. And so,
because I've been involved, when I'm standing in the aisle of pink, the ones that I can see first are like, or the cheap ones, are, basic color. They don't have a whole lot of fancy, that's more red. They come in, there's two versions in the cheap pink. It ain't like 18 different reds when you buy the two pink.
I love you, so I won't go there. I would like us to get up and talk. Should we talk about a couple pieces of work? If you had to pick your favorite, Michelle, what would be your favorite?
My son, Ashley, is my favorite piece.
You're ready to
my love song. I'm sorry. In this show, the portrait of my eldest son is my favorite piece. The title of it is Modest Peacock, and it is very much him and like who he is as a person. Like he has a very like exuberant, flamboyant nature. But every once in a while, like me and my wife will be having a conversation about stuff that he won't really want to hear about, and he gets really shy. Or certain things make him really shy. Or I'll pull out my camera and he won't look.
Or like you're talking about him right now.
Right, yeah. Right. Like, and so, but he's a dancer. He's a performer. And so he's, I can't do this whole thing anymore. I'm not going to try. But he's going to be in one of my shows, hopefully this year. I'm going to have a performer that will be part of it. But so it's this balance of, like, the flamboyance of both his hair and his halo, juxtaposed against the fact that he's one of the few characters that isn't actually looking at you. There are only a few people that aren't looking at you in all of the portraits. And it's just that kind of an energy that sometimes he won't look at you. He's paying attention to it, just listen for it. There's sort of this modest shyness about it. And it's just really beautiful. And he kind of looked like me, so I said, like, I love my mom. At the same time. So that's my favorite one in this show.
Okay. And did you enjoy working in the graphite and the china marker?
Yes.
Better than working in the paint in this show?
It's faster, more expressive, and more fun to do the graphite and china marker, or as I have now changed it I was having a conversation with him about those. China Rock is also called grease pencil. Effectively, what people there trade for, grease pencil. And so when I buy the grease pencil, just sound really sexy. So it's going to be graphite. It's the same material. It's just another name for it.
I'm asking you for this opportunity.
A grease pencil.
How about that? And so the next show has a lot of gold, graphite, and grease pencil. I'm a guy, so you know.
Grease. Did I tell you that women buy art more than men do? So you might want to appeal.
You see, China Market just China Market. Ethnically. Like, China Market. I don't want to hear it in my head. I sound like I'm saying something offensive, even though I know I'm not.
It has to do with the Chinese people.
So why is
China like porcelain?
Oh, man! I'm taking you back to school!
Porcelain.
I wrote on the last one.
Right, so it's what you would mark.
See, we all learn things in red.
That's what you because mean. It would stay. Yes.
See, this okay. is why I keep putting my life.
One of the many reasons.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about. Hello, how are you, sir?
Hello.
I would like to talk about the one piece that's not for sale.
Oh.
In here.
I bought it.
If we can figure out how to, can we figure that out?
Right. I mean, if like, somebody is willing.
It's like the Mystery Mansion. When Mystery Mansion left his apartment, his first apartment in Chicago, they were able to dismantle some of the walls and keep the safe. This piece was done 2 nights before the show opened.
Yes.
Rob Welch and I were in here. I saw him, Philip was in, and I saw him, and I said, what are you? Oh, man, for doing this, I'm going to
right, she saw me break out the paint and put the image on the wall, and like, you got, oh, because the show wasn't hung yet. I still had to hang the show, and I'm, you know, over here being creative, and like, everything else was done and ready, and it's on the floor. And I got 2 days till it's open, and I'm like, but I want to do something on the wall. And my wife was like, hey, you don't have to do, and at first I wanted to do it live. She was like, you got enough paint for me. Calm down. Do this thing.
Thank you.
Right. But, and there were a few other things on the walls in here, but there was a little too much, so I got rid of it. See.
So tell us about the self-portrait. And why the self-portrait is different than the other portraiture. Or is there any difference between how you see yourself and how you look at others?
Yes. I am ridiculously self-conscious. My wife thinks I'm vain. Because I spend a little time like doing stuff to get ready. But it's really because I'm like, okay, am I all right? I'm really actually internally freaking out like this 16-year-old girl. But, I wanted to do something fun, and I did have one self-portrait of me, but it's not recognizable. Actually, there are a couple of me. Which brings me back to college. But I wanted to do something on the wall. I wanted to feel like it belonged in the space. And then also, like, this show is very much a reintroduction of me into the art world. And so I wanted to do the big portrait of me. Like, hey, I exist. I'm Dave. Pay attention. If you walk around the gallery, you don't know who I am. Yes, you do. I see it like that. And it was fun.
So, in line with your vanity, we are now going to open up the floor to questions directly to you about the work that's in this show. Do I have any questions? Questions or comments?
I'll start. I think the show first because I do like the switching color palette. Can you tell us more about why each one of the painting figures have cables on or this representation of
Yeah.
Do we have to?
The kids misunderstood something I said, that I was, whether or not I know God exists. And I say, well, no, I don't know God exists. I believe God exists. I think belief is kind of a powerful thing to know. Like, I know that's the thing that's right there in front of me. And it's, it, like, depending on how you interpret it, it's really weird. And I can sit and talk like that. But the halos represent the divinity or the connection to God that I see in us. And everybody's halo is a little different because we express that differently. Some of us express it more than others, and so our halos just shine real bright. Some of us kind of, you know, don't know we have it and don't really show it that much. So we really suffer. And there's also a beautiful decorative element to it. You know, like my work, I think, is a combination of, like, I'm always balancing wanting things to work aesthetically and communicate the idea so that the content and the form kind of become seamless and work together. You know, so that they both communicate what I want to communicate at the same time. And so most everybody has a halo or some sort of a animation from around the head region. Sometimes it's soft and subtle. It could be a series of dots which connect to the Celtic and Aboriginal cultures. And some of them, and some folks have crowns, which also kind of exemplify the same.
I'm always interested in stuff like people when you use like religious type
of. I love Byzantine portraiture, the icons. I think they're absolutely gorgeous. You know, funny enough, I had a conversation with somebody who was like, right, well, they had like icons. So apparently there were, you know, and I like history very much. But there are things that I want to learn then now, because this thing that I love is beautiful. It didn't really feel a cultural connection to, just an aesthetic one. And now knowing that there is some cultural connection, I'm going to get a little deeper into that. And religion fascinates me. So pulling from religious imagery and how we communicate the idea of God. Across the cultures and on the planet, which is also very fascinating and beautiful.
Any other questions or comments? Yes. I've noticed that on all these people, there's no tea showing. Is there a reason why there's just no expression of happiness in there? I mean, it looks like,
see, she's got a smile.
She has a smirk.
Smile. I
don't like tea.
I don't like to paint tea. I don't like to draw tea. I can do it accurately. I just don't like it. It's an unpleasant activity. There's something really beautiful about the portrait. No, like, it's really funny. Because, like, my wife, the smile is what happens. But she's the artist person on the planet to make artwork of. There's the top one of the small three pieces is her. And although that piece is beautiful to me, it's still a little gray. I have yet to, in 18 years that I've been, that I've considered myself an artist, get it right. Even with the photography, I still have issues with it. I don't know what that is.
It's so funny, even with the children, their expression seems very without. But that was something you were working for, because when I look throughout the whole show, it does look like there's a level of oppression and depression that I see.
It's more of a quietness, and I guess.
But then it always, then it kind of came to ties back to me when you kept talking about the issue of money when you did the show. I was wondering, did that have any
effects
on you?
I try not to be pressed on money, so I don't quite pretend that it's not an issue. I just do things that I can't.
I do that enough for us both.
Right,
Hey, we got love, man.
I'm a happy guy.
Right.
But there is underneath, it's not a facade. Like, my happiness, I'm a genuinely happy guy. But I'm still very much like a duck on the water. I don't know if you guys know that expression. You ever seen a duck on the water? They just chill. I get it. They're not really nice. Underneath, but they're like,
right.
That's what they're doing underneath the water. And that's how, like, I'm sorry, did you feel that?
I did get it, actually.
I'm with you. Okay. It might commit my but that's how I feel. Like, all the time. I'm always like that. Like, on the surface, I'm just cool. Like, I figured out how to make it work. Things will pan out. But I am constantly, all the time. And so, that kind of duality, I guess, presents itself in the work. And I can say, I guess, it's a thing. They have potential to be happy. Mm-hmm. Although, there's a show that I want to do. Called expressions, and I want to do like very expressive images, whether they're sad, happy, whatever, but whether it's about the expression. I'm just loving portraiture and face right now, and so I think I'm going to continue pushing in that direction. And you have a question?
Just to tell us about the lines, everybody who don't know about that.
Okay, the lines and the circles and the markings. It's how I learned a long time ago to separate the tonal areas in a face or a thing, whatever. And I remember, like, it's really funny, because I was going to bring my first painting. I forgot. It's a little abstract piece. This is actually really abstract. It's called Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
Did you even get that from the tone? I said, that means, not really. And so everything was like all heavy, and I was blue black. Like, I was black.
Oh, you're feeling it though?
Yes.
Okay.
You like to be back there. And so everything was kind of around it. But that motion, that shape, that all of that finds its way into my work everywhere. Even in the stuff that I keep calling abstract, it runs everywhere. It was there. But when I'm drawing it in the faces, it is structurally how the face is broken up. And then
I get a little happier. So I might be a little sad. Yeah.
There are work that is priced to walk right out the door with you, and there's work for you to have a discussion with the gallery owner, Phil Scott, about. The show is up until May the 5th, which is only another week. You have enough time to get back, bring other people with you. The whole point for artists to keep making work is to keep living. You got beautiful children.
Amen. No, your studio that spills over into the dining room, into the kitchen, into the living room, into our bedroom.
I will say this, when I look at them, and when you see artists who are creating in this this heavy negative at the top, it does bring it to a time period, because so often you taught in art and you know, or the placement of people's
room.
So I think now all these rules are going to be broken.
Yes. So I love, you know, because as a photographer and an artist, you know, composition is like strong.
Yeah.
And some of that I got from my mentor. He was like, understand what works really well for the human brain. Mm-hmm. Like people respond to something being in a particular place. If you put the eye in the right spot, people are like drawn to it more than if I stick it in the bottom left hand corner. They're like, all right, what is the eyeball in the bottom left hand corner? And so that's a part of it. Like,
looked at them and I thought, okay, when you put these people in, it made them even more godly because they were like that. Mm-hmm. Because it calls, it was so much more attention placed on the halo.
Yeah.
That's what I took out of it. And then they had this like free zone around it, and it kind of felt very godly when I looked, when I first saw these. I don't know what's true of this, but I took out of it. But
there's some of it.
Yeah. I think it gave the halo more to breathe, and also it just kind of made it. The halo became an emphasis as well as the placing on,
right?
Did you work on it? That's what I took out. I just want to make a lot of money.
No, you weren't.
Okay. I'm sorry.
If I'm keeping it off.
Keep on doing another speech.
This one, that's the progenitor of all of this. That's where it all started. This is on the wall. It is a lot more expressive because I started that piece in 2005, right after we got here. And I started it and I tucked it in the corner and I did this whole training series. And I just never took it out of the corner until end of last year, beginning of this year. And I started working on it again and then all of this happened. So that's where coming back to that. This was me coming back to me.
Not knowing the title, what does the bird represent?
Freedom. And it's also like an avatar kind of represents him, in a sense. It's like, it's you know, it's really funny because we've had conversations about like wings and birds. The same idea of being separate from where you are, who you are, and being able to leave that very much ties into it the same way. That's a thing for me.
Your pieces seem to be, I get the impression, more linear, more okay. Lengthwise.
Yeah,
is that a
okay? It's me. I'm Collins King, and I just am attracted to Collins King.
Not this way, boo.
Right. No, as a form, no. There's a whole other show. And I haven't done it yet. But it's all about curvy. A lot of that works for me, No, not that I didn't.
Tell me, iconic graphic, expression, lines, face.
Oh, okay. No, I'm going to that's good. I'm going to have to, you're going to have to write that down to me so I can take that.
I think it's just lovely.
Well, I take it, brother, since you're sharing some insights with some pieces, Maya. The black piece over there is getting my eye. See?
Black and white brown.
Mm-hmm. You got it. It seems to not have some of the effects that you talked about this afternoon.
Okay.
The angles and things.
The brown places.
It has the topography with the circles that I can see and all the other things.
Right.
So share a little bit about that piece.
The subtleness, if you come in closer, there, it has all the same structural stuff. It's just, I was feeling really expressive when I was working on this piece, so it's a lot looser than most of the other work. And she's just really beautiful. She's actually one of the ones that's not a real person.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to get to. It's the same as representation of some of the other
people. Yeah, she's the only one that's not a real person. I have to look around. She's the only one that's not. Well, I mean, she's a real person. And I just like the counterbalance of the crown.
Look at the space.
Yeah.